Almighty God, judgment.
But I'm heartily sorry for them, and sincerely repent of them, and I pray of your boundless mercy, and for the sake of all innocent bitter sufferings and death of your beloved Son, Jesus Christ, to be gracious and merciful to me, a poor sinful being. Upon this, your confession, I, by virtue of my office, as a called and ordained servant of the Word, announce the grace of God unto all of you. And in the stead, by the command of my Lord Jesus Christ, I forgive you all your sins. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. The hymn brought for this morning is Psalm 146, found in the front part of the hymnal. We will pray Psalm 146, responsibly half verse for half verse, and I will begin. Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord, O my soul.
I will praise the Lord as long as I live.
I will sing praises to my God while I have my being.
Put not your trust in princes,
in the Son of Man, in whom there is no salvation.
When his breath departs, he returns to the earth.
On that very day, his plans perish.
Blessed is he whose help is the God of Jacob, who made heaven and earth, the sea, and all that is in them.
He keeps faith forever.
Who executes justice for the oppressed,
he gives food to the hungry.
The Lord sets the prisoners free. The Lord opens the eyes of the blind.
The Lord lifts up those who are bowed down. The Lord loves the righteous.
The Lord watches over the sojourners. He upholds the widow and the fatherless.
But the way of the wicked he brings to ruin.
The Lord will reign forever.
Your God is Zion to all generations. Praise the Lord.
And let us continue by singing the glory of Audrey, as it is found on the top of page 186. In the front of the hymnal.
Oh.
mind.
Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Managing their children and their households well, for those who serve well as deacons gain a good standing for themselves and also great confidence in the faith that is in Christ Jesus. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Christ the Light.
Christ, and penned by St. Luke the Blessed Evangelist, on the inspiration of the Spirit, you find a theme whose orientation is true riches. We live in a world that are filled with opposites, up and down, left and right, north and south, east and west, over here and over there, wet and dry, night and day, light and darkness. Those who are believers and those who are unbelievers. The false riches of the fallen broken world and the true riches of the kingdom of God. All these are complete opposites. This brings us to the gospel lesson for this morning. And as we look at the gospel lesson this morning, we find the Holy Spirit making this distinction between true riches of the kingdom of God and the false riches of the fallen, broken world in which we live. Those false riches, they come from the dust and dirt of the ground, and they shall return to the dirt and dust of the ground. Those false riches are passing away, but they sparkle and they glitter and they shine. And so they start with those things that sparkle and glitter and shine. Gold, silver, money, and all those things that go along with having a lot of money and being rich. Having power and control, fame, pride, and arrogance, control and manipulation. All these things are alluring. All these things are seductive. All these things captivate the mind, the body, the spirit, and the soul. These are the false gods of this life and this world. These are the false riches of the fallen, broken world, leading up to the last one. And the last one is this: not spending eternity in paradise, where there's peace and joy and happiness, but rather spending eternity in a place called hell, where God exists only according to his wrath and his punishment, the flames and the torture. The true riches are the true riches of the kingdom of God, the spiritual treasures, the spiritual riches. They are given by our God according to his love and his grace and his mercy. They are given to us from God's cup of blessings, gifts, and benefits that has no bottom and no limit and no end. They include the gift of saving faith in knowing Jesus by faith as Lord and Savior and Redeemer. They include the forgiveness of sins, knowing that all of our sins and all the sins committed against us died when Jesus died upon the cross on Good Friday. They are no more. They include a new man, the desire to want to live a God-pleasing life. They include the promise of eternal life in paradise. You and I, we know where we're going, where we're called home, to the Father's house, to the room that our Jesus has prepared for us with our name on it, to that place where there is just peace, joy, and happiness, even for all of eternity. And finally this: peace of God, which passes all human understanding. Knowing that by faith our God will never forsake us, or forget us, or abandon us. In the good times, the bad times, the horrible times, he will always remain by our side to lead us and to guide us. And somehow and in some way, especially in the worst and most horrible times of our life, to watch over us and take care of us and provide for us. In all of life, in all of death, in all of resurrection, even for all of eternity. These are the true riches, the riches of God, the true riches of the kingdom of God. This brings us to the gospel lesson for today. was addressing the Pharisees. And the Holy Spirit described the Pharisees as the lovers of money. And all that went along with being a lover of money. He came to seek and save the lost, even the Pharisees. So the teacher taught, they taught within the parable of the rich guy and Lazarus. So there was this Jewish rich guy, and he was richer than rich. He had money falling out of his ears. And of course, because he was so rich, he wore the finest clothes, the Oakley sunglasses, the Armenian robes, the Gucci sandals, even drove a Maserati chariot. And because he was so rich, when he ate, every meal was nothing but the best of the best, the finest of wines and the finest of foods, breakfast, lunch, and supper. Every meal was a feast for him. It was the best of the best and plenty to go around. He was the rich guy. Because he was Jewish, every Sabbath he was found on Saturday morning to be in synagogue, to hear the voice and the words of Moses, to hear the voice and the words of the prophets. Faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. But here was also the problem that the false god for the rich guy was his money, all the power, all of the revelation, all the pride, all the arrogance, all the glory, all the pain. And so when he heard the voice, the words of Moses and the prophets, because his heart was hard as a rock, so too his ears were stopped. And because money was his God, money controlled him. In his heart and his mind, he thought, this is mine. I can do with it whatever I want, and this is mine. So he had no love for God. He had no love for his neighbor. He did not give one red penny to the beggar who sat at his gate, and not one morsel of food. The rich guy, he was rich with all the false riches of the fallen and broken world on the outside, but he was poor. Had none of the riches, the true riches, of the kingdom of God on the inside. Then there was the beggar who sat at the gate. He too had a name. His name was Lazarus, the exact opposite of the rich guy. He had some sort of infirmity caused him to be a beggar. So he had to beg and depend upon the mercy of other people. Depend upon their mercy to give him money, to buy food. Depend upon their mercy to give him clothes. Depend upon their mercy to provide a blanket for warmth at night. He too was Jewish. He too had heard the voice and the words of Moses and the prophets. He too had heard of the promised Messiah who would come and take away the sins of God's holy people. Faith comes by hearing and hearing by the word of God. And the seeds of faith were planted in his heart, along with forgiveness of all his sins. A new man, the desire to want to live a God-pleasing life, the promise of everlasting life in paradise, and the knowledge that when he dies, he would be going home to paradise, where there's peace and joy and happiness for all of eternity. And by faith, knowing this one thing, the peace of God that passes all human understanding, that even God was with him in the worst and most horrible time of his life, him having to be a beggar, leading him, guiding him, watching over him, taking care of him, and providing for him, not only in this life, but also in the life. The beggar Lazarus was the exact opposite of the rich guy because he had no false riches of the fallen broken world on the outside, but he was filled with the riches of God and the kingdom of God on the inside. Both men died, the rich man and Lazarus. resurrection of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, they both received in eternity a perfect body. And that both of them had to stand before the eternal judge. God, the eternal judge, who sees everything, who hears everything, who knows everything. You can hide things from your friends, from your family, from your relatives, from the world. You can hide nothing from God. He knows it all. He can look into our hearts and minds and know what's going on. So, the eternal judge looked into the heart of Lazarus, found that he had faith in Jesus as Lord and Savior and Redeemer, and said to Lazarus, "Good job. Well done, thou good and faithful servant, receiving thou the crown of everlasting life." And Lazarus took his perfect body into a place called paradise, with his peace, joy, and happiness, even for all eternity. Now the overabundance of the riches of the kingdom of God. And the eternal judge looked at the rich man and looked into his heart. He saw his heart was hard as a rock, had no faith in Jesus. And so the eternal judge, he spoke the eternal judgment. "Depart from me, you evildoer. I do not know you." And he was cast into hell, even for all of eternity, receiving the final treasure of the riches of the fallen. So there was the rich guy in hell. He looked up and he saw Father Abraham and Lazarus from a distance. And he said to Father Abraham, "Father Abraham, please have mercy upon me," even though I had no mercy upon Lazarus or anybody else. "But Father Abraham, please have mercy upon me. I want you to have Lazarus dip his finger in water and come down here in hell and touch my tongue, so I can be comforted." Father Abraham looked at the rich man and said, "My son, my son, no can do. Because the words and ways of the will of God are fixed. His ways are higher than our ways, his thoughts are higher than our thoughts. And they do not change society or culture or the world, for all time, for all of eternity. God has fixed it so that there's a chasm between heaven and hell. And you cannot cross over to us, and we cannot cross over to you." Now we take one step back and look at the rich guy. Even in hell, he is filled with power and arrogance and pride, thinking he can control and manipulate even Father Abraham and Lazarus, and tell them what to do, and how to do it, and when to do it. That's what he did in his previous life, with all his power and money and gold. But of no avail now, because of God. Things are fixed with our God. His word, his way, his will, even for all of eternity. So then the rich man said, "Father Abraham, go to my father's house. I have five brothers, and I do not want them to be with me in hell for all of eternity." So Father Abraham sent Lazarus to my brothers, so they could see one who has died and been resurrected from the dead, and so they don't wind up here. And Father Abraham looked at the rich guy and said, "My son, my son, what can you do? The word, the way, and the will of God, they are fixed. You do not change in society, in culture, in the world, or even time or eternity. Your brothers, they too have the opportunity to listen to the voice and words of Moses and the voice and words of the prophets. Faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. And here's the problem. Lazarus is not a called and sent one. He is not like me, Father Abraham. He is not like Moses, and he is not like one of the prophets. He is not a called messenger of the Most High. And the other problem is, the message is wrong.
The message that Lazarus died and was resurrected again can save no one. All the signs and wonders of this life and world, they only affirm and confirm the messenger and the message. And this is the most important message, the message proclaimed by Moses and the prophets, that Jesus is the resurrection and the life, that it's his life and death and resurrection that saves, and only that. So, again, we're amazed at the rich man. He believed, even in hell, he had the power, the control, and the manipulation to tell Father Abraham and Lazarus what to do, and when to do it, and how to do it. But to no avail, because the word, and the ways, and the will of God are fixed. They do not change with society, they do not change with culture, they do not change with the world, they do not change with time and eternity. They remain fixed. Now it comes down to you. Now it comes down to me. And you and I are most like Lazarus, aren't we? Because now you and I are the baptized and the faithful. Now you and I, we have heard the voice and words of Moses and the voice and words of the prophet. And faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. And now we have faith in Jesus as our Lord and Savior, Redeemer. Now we know that all of our sins died when Jesus died upon the cross, and they are no more. Now we have a new man, the desire to want to live a God-pleasing life. Now you and I have the promise of eternal salvation. And now you and I know that no matter what, our God should remain by our side to lead us, to guide us, to watch over us, take care of us, and provide for us. In the good times, in the bad, today and tomorrow, and even before all eternity. But you and I live in a fallen, broken world. Every day the fallen, broken world pounds on us and holds before us its riches and its treasures, those things that sparkle and glitter and gleam, and all too often they become the most important thing. Gotta have that. Gotta have that right now in order to be fulfilled and satisfied. Me and you and everyone here, we all have a sinful flesh. We're all powered upon by the old evil flow 24/7. We all fall short. So we look to our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, who does not fall short. He is the one spoken about by Moses and the prophets, the promised Messiah, who God had promised to send, deliver his people from sin and Satan and death. He is the King of Kings. He is our greatest treasure. He is our biggest, richest thing that we have. He's the King of Kings, who is rich with everything that belongs in the kingdom of heaven, who allowed himself to come poor and come down from above from the outside to be our promised Messiah. To become poor, conceived by the Holy Spirit, and born of the Virgin Mary. To become poor, born of the Virgin Mary, to take upon himself a human body with a human soul, so he could be our replacement. So he could keep the Ten Commandments perfectly for you and me, because we can. So we could go to the cross and take all the punishment for all of your sins and my sins, and pay for the fault of his life and body and blood, so that we can have forgiveness and life. Salvation. He is the one who became poor for you and me, so you and I could become rich in him. He became poor, becoming conceived by the Holy Spirit, being fully God as the promised Messiah, to do all those things that only God can do. Only God can defeat all the sin of his righteousness, and all of Satan of his love, and all of death of resurrection and new life. So you and I can be rich in Christ. So you and I can be filled with the riches of the kingdom of God, the true riches. Yeah. Now it comes back to you. Now it comes back to me, the baptized and the faithful. You and I are the ones who hunger and thirst for righteousness. For you and me, Christ crucified and resurrected is the only thing and the only one that will do. For you and me, we long and thirst for the ongoing wedding banquet that we call Holy Communion. For you and I, the finest of foods, the finest of wines, that to which our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ has added his very body and blood, so you and I can be forgiven, washed and cleansed and purified and reconciled, made to be at peace with God, made to be at peace with ourselves, and made to be at peace with our neighbor. So you and I can eat and drink of his body and blood, that which has already died upon the cross, that which has already been resurrected from the dead, that which has conquered all of sin and all of Satan and all of death for all of eternity. That which provides healing to the body and the spirit, the mind and the soul, for the greatest riches of God and the kingdom of God. You and I are God's holy people. Hunger and we thirst for righteousness, for the righteousness of the crucified and resurrected Christ. We long to be in the presence of the Good Shepherd, to hear the old familiar voice and the old familiar words, because they give to us what we need, more than we even know. As we listen to his voice and his words, we partake of the divine exchanges. The bad is replaced by the good. The old is replaced by the new. Weakness is replaced by his strength. Death is replaced by a new life. And as you listen to the voice and the words of the old of Jesus, he then reminds us of this one promise, the peace of God that passes all human understanding. For you and me as we go through life, the good times, the bad times, the horrible times, the tough times. He promises to remain by our side. We are connected to him, and he is connected to us. We believe in the real presence of Christ. We are duct taped and super glued to him, shoulder to shoulder, hip to hip, kneecap to kneecap, and shin to shin, and him to us. Shoulder to shoulder, hip to hip, kneecap to kneecap, and shin to shin. And the reason that's so important for you and me is so he can remind us that he will always remain by our side to lead us, to guide us, to watch over us, take care of us, provide for us in all of life and all of death and all of resurrection. These are the true riches. The true riches of kingdom of God, the true riches of our God, the one that you and I can always depend upon, the one that you and I can always trust in, the one that you and I can always count upon, no matter what, today, tomorrow, even before, all of eternity. In Jesus' name, amen. Now the peace of God that passes all human understanding, may it bless you and pay for life everlasting. Amen. Let us stand and sing the creed in me.
Oh,
Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our
prayer. What a blight that the flock of the gold, your fallen, when you need them, all wrath, all in threats, Arlen Rabbi, Sheila Hall. My grace receive healing and strength from you. They of us might be thankful in sickness and health. In my grandma's strength to accept your will for their eternal lives, visit them in their afflictions, and empower them with your word and the promise of your love. Lord, in your mercy, all-powerful Creator, we praise you for blessing the earth to make it fruitful. Bring forth in abundance whatever is needed for the support of our lives. For us, we implore you to work of ranch farmers and grant us a perfect weather of sunshine and rain. We both have a seed time and a gathering of the fruits of the earth, thus proclaiming your goodness with thanksgiving. Lord, in your mercy.
Amen.
O Victor of the grave, be mine, grant us your peace with the death of Vienna, granddaughter of Howard Runge. If we have confidence in your gracious and merciful redemption alone, we thank you for blessings to this departed loved one. Teach us to number our days and apply our hearts to righteousness that we may finally be saved. Lord, in your mercy.
Amen.
Your hands, O Lord, we would often we pray, trusting in your mercy, through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord. Amen. Lord, we should bring down to just pray, our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, deliver us from evil, for thy is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. You may be seated. Let us continue by singing the Thanksgiving hymn, and in our 51, Lord of Glory.
Thank you.
lift up his hands upon you and give you his peace.